Hi, Satya. Welcome to the PG&E 2024 Innovation Summit. We are gathered here today, and we are so glad that you can spend a few minutes with us.
No, really thrilled to be with you, Patti, and thanks for the opportunity.
Well, Satya, there's no doubt that you personally and Microsoft as a team have had major impact in the space of AI. And you work with all sorts of industries, but you spend quite a bit of time thinking about energy, working on energy with utilities. I'd love to know how you think AI is going to impact utilities.
No, first of all, it's such an important partnership that we have with you and your entire industry and sector. If I think about even, Patti, if I step back 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when we think about the new infrastructure that any community or any country needs in order to drive, I would call it broad spectrum economic growth, I think it's the nexus between energy to compute to connectivity, right? That's it. In fact, there's an equation I think of, which is tokens per dollar per watt. That ultimately is what's going to drive the future of education or healthcare or small business or public sector, pick your part of the economy. And so in that context, what you're doing, what broadly the investments the energy sector is making in order to not only generate the energy, help us with our energy transition, but also more importantly, the grid. Because ultimately, even people like us can talk sometimes behind the meter solutions, which are innovative. But I think ultimately what is needed is really a grid solution that allows us to truly have the energy we need in order to power this compute. And then deliver the benefits of this compute to every business out there and every institution out there. So I think it's a very important critical partnership where we will have to all collaborate together to build solutions. And a good example, I think, is even some of the work that we've been doing between yourselves and Schneider Electric and us, and even this, you know, distributed energy resource management infrastructure that it was your vision to build that. And that's something that I think those are the kinds of projects that I think will be critical for us.
Oh, I love that, Satya. Thank you. You're singing my song. We need a great grid to deliver this new technology. I agree. Now, I also know, Satya, that you have a real passion for people and culture. You and I have that in common. I think we lead our companies from that place. How do we lead our teams through the deployment of this technology? How do you think about enrolling your team and applying AI throughout our businesses?
Yeah, it's a great question, Patti, because at some level, the fundamental thing that's happening is, I would say, workflow and work artifacts are changing. In fact, I will go back even to the very beginning of, let's say, the PC era, right? You know, there was a time in the late 80s, perhaps, pre-PC, when in order to do something even as simple as a forecast, we sent faxes around and then someone tabulated those faxes into an inter-office memo. And then we had a forecast after a month or two. Whereas now, you know, after, you know, the Excel and email, somebody said, oh, let me just put an Excel spreadsheet, put some numbers in it, and send it an email, and everybody will enter, and then we'll have a forecast in, you know, minutes. And that type of change is what's happening in our workplace today, right? So in fact, one of the things with Copilot I say is that I think with Copilot and collaborate with my colleagues at work, right? So that new workflow is I use Copilot to collect information, reason about information, but then I'm ultimately working with others inside the organization based on the artifacts that I create using Copilot. And I think that that requires us to do a couple of things. One is do the broad skilling, right? Just in fact, to demystify a little bit of AI is no different than perhaps learning how to use Word or Excel. I think this is where I think we've taken sometimes AI and said, well, this is an elite skill. There is an elite skill too. But the real everyday skill for us is to broadly get the organization using tools like Copilot, like they would use a Word or Excel, getting comfortable to reimagine how they do their work. So that's sort of the first level. The second I would say is, in fact, what you built, I think you built a tool called Peggy, if I understand it right, which is sort of for your employees self-service. That's so fantastic. It's just but that was built using something like Copilot Studio. So your own IT organization building tools using this new technology is the second thing that I think all of us can do to streamline again how even self-service works, right, inside of an organization. In the past, you would have built a mobile app or a website. Guess what? Going forward, you build an AI tool to be able to achieve that, which is more conversational. And then, of course, the last thing is while we deploy AI, we are all excited about it, we realize that we have to make sure we take security, we take AI safety as first order priorities, not something we fix later. And that's also something that's, we turn it into an engineering practice. And that's, those will be the three things that I think we all will have to sort of really learn. One is to just use it as a tool in every day, start building tools that make sense for us in our business process context, and do it safely.
That's awesome. It's going to be an exciting time, that's for sure. Well, you know, here at PG&E, we've taken a stand to deliver clean and resilient energy for all. And what that means is we want no one left behind as we go through the energy transition and decarbonize the economy. I'm sure you've thought about how society broadly will be affected by AI. And I'm just curious how you think about how we make sure that everyone gets to enjoy the benefits of AI more broadly.
Yeah, first of all, you know, we're excited, quite frankly, with our capital investments and our, I'll call it, offtake investments that we are stimulating in some sense, even the investment in the energy sector, right? Because at some level, if you think about what's happening with us and other hyperscalers and in general AI, I think you could even think of it as perhaps the best stimulus for the grid, for the modernization of the grid, for the energy transition and the renewable projects and their project financing, because after all, we would be more guaranteed demand. So that's sort of one side where I think there's a societal benefit coming upstream, so to speak. Then ultimately, what you do and what we do will translate into this new abundance of tokens or intelligence that can be used. I mean, think about this, Patti. We now can dream the dream of giving every student in the United States a personalized tutor. Right? I mean, that was something that we could have not thought of. I mean, it doesn't substitute teachers. It doesn't do any of that. This is just being able to take and augment the education that our students are receiving with more personalized tutoring that really will help them learn the learning curve. Same thing with healthcare. It doesn't substitute for great nurses or doctors in our healthcare institutions, but we can give medical advice, right? And then streamline. After all, healthcare is all about workflow cost. We can streamline healthcare. And public sector. Right, because that's another one where we talk a lot about all the things that are happening in the private sector. But what if the public sector could get more efficient with our tax dollars using AI? Those are societal benefits, right? So if we do our job with energy, we do our job with compute, and we do our job with connectivity, it's actually this broader benefits to society that I think will ultimately be the things that drive even this economy forward.
Well, I am going to reinforce your first point here, Satya. There is no doubt, and I am on a campaign to make sure everybody knows that the growth that AI and computing and data centers is driving will, in fact, fund the rebuilding of our national grid. It will fund the decarbonizing of our economy. Without that new load growth, we would just be paying for it twice because it's gotten old. Now we get to modernize it, decarbonize it, and we can do it at a lower cost thanks to the growth driven by all of this computing. So I couldn't be more excited about that. Okay, last question, speed round. How are you using AI in your everyday life? Any tips for us here today?
Yeah, my everyday tool now, first thing I do get up when I get up in the morning is we have this new feature in Copilot where in Outlook, it's like someone went out there and took every mail and wrote a one-line prioritizing the mail, right? So it's, think of it as somebody labeling your mail for you so that your attention, there's these blue lines. So that's kind of my everyday thing that I do all the time. The other one that's very, very cool is whenever I get an Excel spreadsheet, it's like it comes with a data analyst that I can ask questions. It just makes the entire process of, you know, how you learn from information so much more real time, and, you know, what we describe as knowledge turns get faster. So those would be two things, because it brings together Outlook is my everyday tool and Excel is another everyday tool. Both of them have changed because of AI.
Oh my gosh, I'm taking notes. You just changed my life. Thank you, Satya. I think you're changing a lot of lives for the better. I'm so thankful for you and the entire Microsoft team for your courage, your leadership. We're so thankful to have had some time with you today. Thank you so much. Be well. I'll see you soon.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the opportunity.